Hello and welcome everyone to the Kootneeti. This is Kavita Sevda. Today we have a very special guest with us, whom we will be interviewing for a book discussion. We have with us today Nirupama Rao.
Good evening. Thank you very much for inviting me on your show.
You're welcome, ma'am. Born in Kerala, India, Nirupama Rao is India's former foreign secretary and ambassador to China. She joined the Indian Foreign Service in 1973, she was India's first woman spokesperson in the Ministry of External Affairs, New Delhi, the first woman high commissioner from her country to Sri Lanka, and the first Indian woman ambassador to the People's Republic of China. She served as India's foreign secretary from 2009 to 2011. She was then India's ambassador to the United States. After her four-decade-long diplomatic career, Ambassador Rao entered the world of academics. Ambassador Rao has also pursued her passion for music and is also a published poet. She has co-founded the South Asian Symphony Foundation to further the cause of peace and mutual understanding in South Asia through the medium of music. Thanks a lot, ma'am, for agreeing for this discussion. We're thrilled to tell our audience that ma'am has recently released her book, The Fractured Himalaya, India, Tibet, China, 1949-62. We are here to discuss the book, know more about it, what went into it, what are the experiences, what are the lessons, and what can the audience, who comprise of young students, professionals, experts, and IR scholars, can learn from it. So here it is to Ambassador Rao.
Here it is.
Well, my first question is that, what is your writing process? And not only writing process, but how did the thought came about to write this book? I mean, in school education and in popular imagination, we have been taught that Himalaya are the continuous line of wall protecting India. But your title is Fractured Himalaya. So what was your thought behind calling it fractured?
It's very true, Kavita, that the Himalayas are our strength, and we have been taught how these mountains are a source of light, are a source of our beliefs, and are a source of strength to our nation. But the story I write about, the narrative in my book, is about the changes that took place in the Himalayan regions once the People's Republic of China had been established, and they had moved into Tibet militarily and controlled it from 1950-51 onwards. And that unleashed a whole sequence of developments in the region that had a profound impact on the Himalayas, on the region along our frontiers. Because as you know, India's borders with Tibet and with China are ringed by the Himalayas. And once the Chinese had entered Tibet, it was as if the mountain barrier that the Himalayas provided for us in terms of security and in terms of our safety was somehow, the situation had changed once they had come. And that is why I call it the fractured Himalaya. Because the Himalayas, which had protected us and which continue to protect us, no doubt, in many ways, somehow had changed once the Chinese entered Tibet.
And ma'am, what in your opinion propelled Jawaharlal Nehru, independent India's first prime minister's vision of China? I found, when it comes to personality, I found him one of the central personalities in your book.
He is a central personality in my book because he drove India's foreign policy during those years. He was India's foreign minister as well as prime minister. And his outlook on China was that both India and China, as newly independent countries, should reach out to each other, should forge a friendship and understanding that would translate into the good of entire Asia, the entire continent of Asia, all the newly independent nations in the region. So he felt that India and China could set an example which was very different from the politics of the Cold War. As you know, the United States and the Soviet Union were at complete loggerheads during that period. The world was divided into these two blocks, East and West, as they were called. And somehow Nehru, in his vision of India's relationship with China, felt that India and China together could set an example, could create this kind of third force, as it were, in world politics that was for peaceful coexistence and for not being a part of any military bloc or either East or West. Although China was a communist nation, in Nehru's view, China was not quintessentially communist. The Chinese would express themselves in a Chinese way. They would not be governed by what the Soviet Union would dictate to them. That was Nehru's assessment from the beginning onwards. So he felt that there was enough room and enough space for India and China to forge a friendship and understanding that was quite apart from the politics of the Cold War and bloc politics.
And Madam, you say in the book, and I quote, "A blame for India's defeat by China is easily apportioned with Jawaharlal Nehru being the chief accused. But history should be envisioned with the aim of understanding the complex warp and weft of its fabric and not through simplistic deduction if it is to be of any value to the course of negotiation of outstanding issues in relation to China." And you also write that decisions are made by leaders in real time and not by scholars in retrospect. So what are the factors to which, you know, the luxury of simplified hindsight blinds those who are blaming Nehru as a chief accused? So what is this, what are these factors that people with this luxury of hindsight are missing?
What I tried to say, that hindsight is very easy for us to have hindsight and say, you know, we have that 2020 vision now through which we can see, through the lens of which we can see everything clearly. It's true, we can see in retrospect. We can see how the history unfolded, where the mistakes were made, where the miscalculations were made, where things could have been done better. But if you were to put yourself back in the 1950s, when India was a young nation, just embarking on its relationship with China, when you did not have the luxury of the hindsight that we have today. I think Nehru, even though he was a proponent and advocate of friendship with China, also understood that India's frontiers had to be secured, that there could be a challenge from China in the long run. I think in some senses, he was aware of it. But in that moment, as I said, India was a new nation, a newly independent nation. India wanted peace on her borders. India wanted friendship with China. As you know, the with Pakistan was extremely difficult. We had already fought a war soon after independence with Pakistan. And I think Nehru felt that it was essential not to that we should, as far as possible, not have a second front opening up on our northern borders through tension with China. So I think he consciously followed a policy where he wanted to settle issues which we had inherited from the British. There were certain imperial privileges that we had inherited from the British in Tibet. And Nehru did not want any of that. He wanted to do away with these imperial privileges as he felt they were. And that is how we negotiated the 1954 agreement with Tibet, on trade with Tibet, as you know, which was called the Panjshir Agreement, because it defined the principles of peaceful coexistence, the five principles of peaceful coexistence. At that time, Nehru assumed that it was not necessary to raise the question of the border with China. Nehru assumed that it would not cause a problem, that it was best left as it is, not to be raised in the negotiations with China. And as we know today from the Chinese archives also, the Chinese also took a conscious decision not to raise it with us. So we know that today with the benefit of hindsight. So there are people who feel that Nehru should have raised the issue of the border with China in 1954. And I also feel, perhaps in retrospect, that that may have been a practical and for India, a useful step, because we would have been able to read the Chinese better if we had raised the question of the border while discussing the Tibet agreement, because the border issue is very much linked to the status of Tibet as the British had defined it. So in a sense, it would have been useful to raise that issue with the Chinese. The Chinese could have turned around and said, we are not ready to discuss this, but we don't recognize, for instance, the McMahon line in the East. All these would have put things in better perspective, perhaps. But as I said, Nehru did not have the benefit of reading the Chinese side of the dispute in a way that we read it today with so much more clarity, because more information is available to us. So decisions, as I said, are made in real time, and there can be no absolute truths about anything. We cannot say who's right and who's wrong in an absolute sense. Yes, Nehru took certain decisions that ultimately did not prove to be right in the way he thought it would be. He had assumed certain positions from the Chinese side. He assumed that they were taking certain positions, that why they had not raised the issue with India was because there was no problem at all as far as the border was concerned. But that was not really, really the case. But let me also add that Nehru was always very clear that India's frontiers need to be defended. He was not soft or yielding when it came to the question of India's borders. He wanted these to be secure, and that is how he took steps, especially in the eastern section of the border, in the northeastern section of the border, to consolidate India's administration and to place our presence right up to the front with Tibet and with China.
Yes, ma'am. And my next question is linked to this question only. That what do you think of Nehru's image as an internationalist and peacemaker as it is related to China? For example, his concern with world peace, insistence on recognizing China as a great power, denial of the offer of UNSC seat offered in lieu of Republic of China. So there is an argument that there is a question generally that would a narrow national security based approach, which would include internal balancing and alliances, have served India's interests better. So what is your opinion on this thing, that a narrow national security based approach would have been better for Indian interests?
Well, I don't know. I would never call Nehru's approach narrow. I really did not. I think it was a very wide lens perspective. Because he wanted peace with China, he wanted China to be admitted into the Committee of Nations, into the UN Security Council, because the situation in Korea necessitated China's active participation and contribution to the discussions and the negotiations that were going on for peace in Korea, and China's position in the Security Council, because China had replaced the communist Chinese regime, had replaced the nationalist Chinese regime by then. So it was the legitimate government of China. And if China had a seat in the Security Council, then the legitimate occupier of that seat should be communist China, because the People's Republic of China was the sovereign government as far as China was concerned at that time. So I think Nehru took that approach, which I don't believe was a wrong approach at all. Because under the Charter of the United Nations, under the structural institutional setup of the United Nations, China was supposed to be a member of the Security Council. That was how the post-World War II scenario had been determined by the victors of World War II. China had been placed as a member of the Security Council. It was just that the nationalist Chinese, that is the Taiwan, the regime in Taiwan, the so-called regime in Taiwan, was occupying that seat when they were really not the sovereign government of the Chinese people and the Chinese mainland as the communist Chinese were. So the communist Chinese regime, the People's Republic of China, was the sovereign Chinese government. So in that sense, they deserved to occupy that seat in the Security Council. I think that was what Nehru was aiming at. And he didn't want India to replace China as a member of the Security Council, because he felt that would really interfere with those decisions taken post-World War II. And also from the point of view as of determination of who the legitimate government of China was, which was the regime, the government in Beijing.
And ma'am, your book also restores Tibet to the centrality and independent agency that it enjoyed in practice and deserves in any telling of the story around the 1962 war. So you remind us that options in the government of India were divided on responding to the Chinese occupation of Tibet and how to approach the boundary question with China. So what were these differences and also the complexity and contemporary context in which these decisions were taken?
Well, I don't believe that any government today, anywhere in the world, could recognize Tibet as an independent entity. Events have flowed since 1950-51. At the point when the Chinese army entered Tibet and Tibet took the issue, the then Tibetan government took the issue to the United Nations, then no country, really no power in the world, supported Tibet at that point of time. Perhaps it would have been useful at least to allow that issue to be articulated by Tibet in order to express the concerns that were felt and the genuine difficulties that the Tibetans faced at that time. But that did not happen. That case was not really taken up in the UN, in the United Nations. And in a sense, Tibet, the case for Tibet was lost at that point of time, and it could not really be revived thereafter. I think Nehru understood also the nature of force and the nature of power. And when the Chinese forces entered Tibet, he knew that India could not go to war with China over Tibet. Tibet was not ours in any case. There is some impression in the country, I find sometimes people say, we didn't really resist what China did in Tibet. But Tibet was not ours in the first place. We must understand that. Tibet was a territory adjacent to our frontiers. We enjoyed very close ties of friendship with the Tibetans. And we had religious connections. We had spiritual connections. We had cultural connections. And trade connections. There's no doubt about it. That kind of osmosis had gone on. But we did not recognize Tibet as a country. You must remember that, even at that stage. So the whole question of resisting Chinese entry into Tibet, unless, it became a global sort of issue. And on the one hand, you had the Korean War that had broken out at that time. The Americans and the British and others were too preoccupied. I don't believe they would have come to the rescue of Tibet either. So in a sense, it is a tragedy, no doubt, but the case for Tibet was literally abandoned at that point, and it could not be resurrected thereafter. And Nehru understood that. Nehru understood that, no force on earth could really unseat the Chinese presence in Tibet once it had consolidated itself. So in that sense, he was a realist. He understood that changes had taken place and they needed to be recognized and to be accepted. But I don't believe his sympathy and his affection for the Tibetan people ever diminished. He was always concerned for their welfare. And I think that also contributed to the decisions taken in 1959 to offer the Dalai Lama asylum and also to offer refuge to so many Tibetans who entered our country and who continue to live in our country after six decades.
Thanks, ma'am. It has been an invigorating session and a lot of food for thought. We are grateful for your insights. I'm sure the audiences watching will also enjoy the discussion as much as I have and would have got to learn most importantly. Thanks for being a part of the interview, and I'm sure the audience will look forward to read your book. And I'm also looking forward to, to looking for a book which deals out the part on India-China relations after 1962. Thanks a lot.
Kavita, I wish you all the best, and my greetings to your viewers also. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.